View of Christ that gathers into itself the inclusive allness of the Lord Jesus and brings that to a finality. Now, if that sounds like a long term or whatever, I have spent the whole time out here explaining that, so I'm not going to go into it again this morning. It means what it says. Means that we find everything that our soul is designed of God to have, we find it in Christ. We say, you know, yeah, we know that our whole salvation is in Christ. Now, that's where I was when I started fooling with my recorder. But we have such a small view of our salvation that oftentimes I will use the term, I agree with that. If you have a true view of salvation, he is Alpha Omega of salvation. If you understand salvation to be more than, you know, what Christian religion sets it out to be. If you understand that salvation is involving an altogether new creation and an altogether new man who is Christ himself. I mean, if you're going to let it be broadened there, then I'll say yes, he is the allness of our salvation. But honey, Sabbath is a term that is much more than just a term, much more than just a word. It is the testimony of God concerning his Son. The testimony of God concerning his Son, both in relation to an old creation and a new creation. The Sabbath gathers into itself the testimony of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, from the beginning of your Bible. From chapter 2, verse 1, 2, and 3, from the seventh day creation. It gathers up into itself the testimony of Jesus Christ from the beginning of your Bible through the end of your Bible. The rest. Now, most Christians, and hon, I'm not down on Christians, my Lord God, are believers. Mostly all I've ever known all of my life are those people in the body of Christ and the church of the Lord Jesus, the world over. I'm not down on, I'm just, so I know what I'm talking about when I say, you say rest to most believers, it means nothing. You say Sabbath. I'm saying it to you right now. Most of you have been, or many of you have been in the other sessions, but let me just say it. Sabbath. Right now, if I said, what does it mean? Brother, what does it mean to you? Sister, what does it mean to you? What does it mean to you? Just think about it. I'm just asking you to think about it. Means very little. Well, that was all with the Jews and it's over with. No, a testimony of it was given to the Jews and it's not over with. The reality of it lives in you. The question is, are you walking in the fullness that He is? Are you walking in the richness that He is? Are you walking in the salvation that He is? We're not bringing any doubt here as to whether you're born again, whether Christ is in you. Everything that I'm saying is based upon you being born again, based upon Christ in you. Everything I'm saying is based upon that. If that's not the reality, then we have to back up and start somewhere else, like having Him to be in you. But upon that basis, we're talking about Sabbath. And I said last night, very as clearly as I can, we are not saying that the Sabbath is the greatness of Christ. We are saying that Christ is the greatness, fullness, and completeness of Sabbath. But Sabbath is an all-inclusive testimony, not only of our salvation, but of the absoluteness of the fullness of God that dwells in Christ. Sabbath is a testimony of that. So we've spent time in some of these sessions with regard to and with some literature and books that your pastor has with regard to Hebraic understanding of the Sabbath, the ancient Jews' understanding of the Sabbath. I read that and I was just totally blown out of the saddle. I was amazed at that. I thought, why don't Christians know this? The Jews knew this, and I have no, and then they missed Him. But if you'll look at what they believe concerning Sabbath, you'll wonder, how did they not see that in Christ? Well, because of their imagination and so forth and so on. They believed Sabbath would be in its finality personified in a man, in a person. Not a natural man, but in a person. They believed that Sabbath spoke of a holiness and a righteousness that was only to be found in the world to come. They believed that Sabbath was, in fact, the presence of God on earth. That's why they were extremely limited in doing anything. And it goes on and on and on, and everything that they believed concerning Sabbath comes to be fulfilled in Christ. Everything that I read. And I'm wondering, and you missed the whole thing that for hundreds, even thousands of years you looked for, and He came, He stood up and said, "Come unto me. I am the Sabbath. Come unto me. I will give you rest." Well, now, darling, how important is that to you? Now, I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings this morning. That's not what I'm here to do. And I wouldn't do it. My God, why would I want to come here and do something that stupid? But give me a little liberty. He'd stand up and say, "Come to me, and I'll heal your body. You got a broke leg, I'll fix it for you." But none of that's bad, hon, but that would, man, people run over themselves. You can break your leg again. You get healed and you can get sick again. Or if you didn't get sick again, you're going to die of something if it's just getting old. Rest. That's what we've been explaining here. Rest is only found in the fullness of the person of the Son of God. Rest is not me sitting down and taking it easy. That That is a small type and shadow of it that can only be experienced in the physical. Rest has bound up with it true substance. Substance. And we see all of that because of what the Sabbath is. You can't separate Sabbath from rest. It was the Sabbath rest. We found doesn't mean Sabbath does not mean seven. No, that was a day that would, no, it doesn't mean seven. Now, the Lord may have chosen the seventh day because of the numerical quality of the word seven, which does speak of a fullness, a completeness, a perfection, and all of that. But, you know, that's numerically. That's another type and shadow, see. Because the Lord turns around then and says, the eighth day, that'll be a Sabbath. And it's the last Sabbath of the Jewish year. And it's on the eighth day. No, honey, don't get too bound up and too confined to numerical types and shadows, whether they're 1,000 years or whether it's a 6-day create, whatever. Whatever. The reality of all of it is in Christ. But I'm just telling you, hon, to the natural ear, Jesus saying that doesn't sound nearly as good as you standing up and promising them a city, or gold streets, or diamond doorknobs. Or go the other way, get spiritual with it. You just keep on going. One of these days you'll be the Christ of God. Or something along that line. You'll end up in the Holy of Holies. I have a book. I have a book on what I call in our library the perversion shelf. In the last chapter, I'm told by that author how that, because they're so, God love them. No, I don't even want to say that. Just pity them. It just kills my heart. And people send me these books. And it just, I read them. I say, why do you read them? I want to see where they're, how they're so far off. What happened when you say that in the, you're looking at the tabernacle, you're dividing it up like it was in dispensations of some God. And that's another thing. The Sabbath just wipes all that out. The Sabbath is not dispensationalized. The Sabbath is one eternal day. There's no dispensations to it. You're either dwelling there or you're not. And if you are, it's eternal. It's in Christ. You bring all of that to Christ. It's not an earthly day. And that's what we've been doing. So for the sake of you that are gathered here, I'm taking this time just to kind of tie some ends together, because I'm going to talk to you about reconciliation in just a moment. And it won't take me long to get it done. But it does open up a whole nother look at the Sabbath. Christ, our Sabbath. Come unto me, I will give you rest. We have said, many of us have talked about the eternal plan and purpose of God. Some of us have talked about it for years and years and years and years and years and have books out of it. But the reality of God's eternal plan and purpose is found in, come unto me, I will give you rest. From Genesis to Revelation, if you ever awaken to it and begin to look at it, and really ask, let the Lord show you the full intention of God concerning His people. The full intention of God, then let's just bring it down, concerning the Lord's body, the Lord's people. is that they find in him the prize of the mark of the high calling. I talked about that last night. I brought it right into this session last night. We're not going to do that again today. But that's the point where Paul was going in Philippians 3. Started out to be found in Christ. Continued on, oh, that I may know him. And to know him in the highest way. And the whole thing is about our soul coming to experience in Christ the fullness of who Christ is, and the fullness of who he is eternal rest. Eternal rest. Now, hon, I know what that sounds like, but we've been laying that out in a way in the scripture that it can't be denied unless you want to throw your Bible away. Why else then would, and it causes me to understand, that's one of the first things he stood up and said to the Jewish nation. He came as a result of their testimony. He told them, you search the scriptures, they testify of me. And then he stood up, and of all the things that he could have said, he said, I am your rest. I'm what your Sabbath day is all about. And we have shown in the scripture in some of these sessions that the Sabbath day was what Israel was all about. There's not one thing in Israel, not one thing, nothing. I mean, from childbirth to gatherings, to marchings, to I don't care what it is, nothing that's not controlled by the Sabbath. God did. Remember the Sabbath. Keep the Sabbath. Remember the Sabbath. Keep. I don't care where they were, what they were doing. The Sabbath was the governing principle. Now, darling, that ought to say something to us when we say that come to find its living reality in Christ. He stood up and said that. I'm just telling you that to most Christians, that's not bad. The only way you can get that to be important to most Christians is if you start painting fantasy pictures of heaven. Yeah. Now, no, you don't believe in heaven? Yes, I do. But I'm talking about some of the fantasies to make it, you know, more or less like a Disneyland, so that Christians then would say, oh, well, yeah, I want to go there. And then we call that. You understand what I'm saying? You have to connect something to that word rest to make it appealing to the natural mind. Because it doesn't appeal to the natural mind. Jesus, the one who stood up and said he was that, did not appeal to the natural mind. Honey, my goodness, he came to his own. He didn't come to a bunch of morons and stupid people and ignorant people and heathen people and, my Lord, people, you know, swinging on vines. He didn't do that. He came to his own, the ones who had the prophets, had the Bible, had everything of the testimony of God. And they received him not. Have you ever, other than just saying, accepting that as a fact, have you ever actually, anybody here, have you ever just sat down for a while and considered why? Well, see, honey, and again, come on now, just don't get upset with me. I'll just come up and put my arm around you and kiss you right on the forehead. I mean, we're not here for that. Just let me have a little license here. hun, we just take, see, we're too busy taking things which can really only be revealed in the reality of Christ and making these doctrines so we can just fight one another over them. Then we come together, man, we've got our doctrines. Everything, if it is brought into Christ and seen in Christ, will testify of this Sabbath. It'll testify of this rest. Everything. The rest of our soul. The rest. So now I'm going to spend just about a few minutes here and just define this rest I'm going to define it in a way that we give a testimony of it verbally. I'm going to define it in word and in the scripture. But honey, my soul will never know it until God reveals it. And I live there walking in the light as He is in the light. Christ Himself, we have seen this in these studies. We have looked at it. It's actually written in your Bible if we just be awakened to it. The glory of the Lord is the light of the Sabbath. The ancient Jews even believed that. They said that the glory of Sabbath will come in the face of a man. Don't you know that Paul knew all of that? Paul knew what the Jews believed. The man was a doctor in that. He knew it. Do you understand then how he talked, why he said, how he framed in words what he knew in truth? When he said, God hath shined in our hearts. Man, see, you talk about shined, Jews says Sabbath. Sabbath. God hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Now, darling, the Jews chased him around with rocks, not because they just didn't like what he looked like, because every place he went, he presented Christ, just like Christ presented himself. And you know well and good that ended up on the cross, but he would have gone to the cross anyway. With Paul, it ended up in being stoned. You know, it looks like about every other day, or you know, we know that it wasn't quite that often. But I'm telling you, hon, he didn't just suck these things out of the end of his thumb. He wasn't just doing allegorical preaching. He was bringing everything that the Jews believed. He knew it. He was trained in it. He had even killed Christians on behalf of it. Now he was standing up and presented it in the person of Jesus Christ. But he was talking about the person of Christ who is in you. You're talking about Christ in you. This Son in you. This Sabbath in you. You in this Sabbath. Now he's talking about the light of it. We would come to know Him. That we would come to know the rest given of God. The rest that God gives is God's own rest. Now we spent a long time on that, looking at day 7 there in Genesis. God's rest. In our natural mind, we can't even imagine it. We can't even imagine it. It's so much more than man not working, or than man not doing this, or man not doing that, though it does embody that as well. But it goes beyond it. So I sat down last night, because I'm out here without computer or printer or anything, so I just tore some pages out and I got back home, and we're going to look at some things here, and I'll leave it with you. The Sabbath day is the day of reconciliation. Reconciliation. Lord, I'd love to take along. We could be here a while on that. I mean, several days. But the Sabbath day just gathers it up. It is the day when all things created of God are reconciled unto Him. Now, I'm making these statements, and I'm not going to be able to go anywhere with them, but we are going to talk about, well, we may answer some of them. The day when all things created of God are reconciled unto Him. All things, I'm talking about, for you are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. I'm talking about the all things of that creation. The Sabbath is the rest designed and purposed for that creation. You'll find no rest in the other. That's why that day was outside the whole realm of the six. The whole realm. I mean, it wasn't even connected to it. And the Jews recognized that and wrote about that. They recognized it spoke of a whole nother realm. And so to them, it had to be one yet to come. And to them it was. But it came. And it came in the person of Christ. It didn't come in the form of Seventh-day Adventist. It didn't come in the form of Sunday morning Sabbath belief. It didn't come in that. It came in Him. Because it hadn't got anything to do with a weekday. Nothing to do with a weekday. It had a testimony in a weekday, a day of the week. But that testimony swallowed that day and swallowed every day that it touched. Oh, hallelujah, hon. The day of reconciliation, the day when all things created of God are reconciled unto Him. What are you talking about? Lord, help us to see it. It's the day of God's satisfaction. It is the day that God blessed. We've looked at that. Remember then when heaven opened, because every time heaven opened that day, Christ appeared in the light of that day, or as the light of that day. Every time heaven opened, eternity was seen. You remember? Right there with the Lord Jesus, the baptism, that's significant because of what that baptism was pointing to, the cross. But not only that, then on the mountain. That's significant because that wasn't talking about that, you understand, was not talking about crucifixion. That was talking about a reality that would come after crucifixion, although the whole thing happened before. But what did He say? Going down, He said, don't talk about this. Why? Well, you know, but I can tell you why. Don't talk about this till I be risen again. Because that whole thing was about His resurrection. That whole thing was about not Him dying, but Him living. Oh, God. Oh, Jesus, Lord, Lord, my Jesus. I wrote that last night, and I sat there and looked at that, and I thought, my God in heaven, my God in heaven. It takes both. His death, whereby you're reconciled, by the way. We're going to look at that. Reconciled by His death. But bound up with this blessing of this day. It's not only His death, but it's Christ in resurrection. It's Christ living in you. It's Christ living in you. See, I know I'm never going to get to finish any of this that I wrote, so I'll just start kind of reaching ahead. Because, honey, in And if I say it again, it won't hurt. Maybe I'll get to it. Maybe I won't. Full rest is not just the absence of you. It's the overwhelming, all-filling presence of Him. My God. It is not just about me being dead. It is about Him being the only one living. Him living. It is in that that I find rest and peace and security. Nowhere else. That to me is reconciliation. That to the scripture is reconciliation, but we may not ever, you know, and I hate time confinement, but that's what we live with, don't we? But it's hard to speak of Him, because in Him there is no such confinement. You try to take just sitting here and sharing on something that is that eternal, and you look at it, you think, good Lord, is it already? I mean, swallows things up. It does with me, because I'm wordy anyway. Oh, darling, 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 darling. The day of God's satisfaction. The day of God's rest. And I just said that. Not only His rest is not only is it the end of the sixth day, but it is the finished completement of the seventh. The end of one in death, the completement of the other in one living. Lives in you. And He lives in you. Hunt, our coming to rest is coming in that inward way that only God can reveal, to the absolute reality that only one does live. It's not me. It's not me. I don't know where I wrote that here or I said that here, but I did write it down. I did write it down somewhere. Yeah, here it is. It's at the end of a whole lot of verses of scripture and a whole lot of things I was going to talk to you about, but here it is. True rest and reconciliation. Now, see if you can hear this. Because there's not, you know, it's hard to say it. True rest and reconciliation. One by death, the other found in the fullness of an altogether other than me being the life of my soul. Not soul life, self life, but rather Christ. He is life. True rest and reconciliation is not me dead, it is me not living, but Christ living in. You understand what I just said? Maybe you don't. It's not about one very wise brother that has worked with me since the early 60s. He's a good deal older than me. He's in his 80s now. That's not a good deal older, but it's older. Precious brother that I love. Used to call me regularly. He's not able to do so anymore that much. But he called me one time, and I had a cell phone at that time, so it's been since the invention of the cell phone, honey, because a lot of my ministry was before that. I used to wear payphones out in the truck stops. Some of you did too. but I certainly did. He called me and he said, you know, and he always just called me J.W. Well, I guess so, Lord. We met in the 60s. And it was in this word. He said, you know, J.W., I was just thinking, people are not afraid to die. And he was talking about people that hear the message of the cross. You know, people are not afraid to die. They're afraid not to live. I've never forgotten that. That's what it comes down to, hon. See, yeah, we're dead, and then, but then somehow or another, see, we can just spin that like a bottle. But I'm alive in Christ. See? It's like people, you know, on just the regular resurrection issues of our bodies, you know. People say, well, okay, I'll die, but then, you know, at some point in time, God's going to raise that body up again. That's not my issue with you right now or with my period. I'm just saying that people are not so much afraid to die because they think they're going to live it. They're going to live again. Now, the issue here, honey, that I do have to make with resurrection, which is Christ, resurrection is not Christ. It's not Christ, honey. It's not. It. You've got to understand it, even in the gibberish of our English, limited English language. That resurrection is not you living again. Resurrection is Christ living in you. And there's a difference. I hope you understand. Because Jesus says, if any man seek to save his own life, and it's translated, as many of you know, soul life. Soul. It's translated that way in the Greek. No getting around it. I didn't make it up. If you forsake it, if you lose it, yes, then you find it again. We're in Him. In Him. So Paul says, for to me, to live is Christ. And I'm glad he said that, or he sounds like an idiot by saying, nevertheless I live, yet not I. Christ liveth in me. Make up your mind. What are you talking about? He's saying, I live because life lives in me. Resurrection lives in me. Resurrection has never, ever lived in my soul until Christ came in. Life never lived in my soul until Christ come in. I had soul life. I had existence. I had whatever you want to call it. I had animation. But life came in when Christ came in. Resurrection came in when the resurrection and the life came into me. And so Paul was not able to say resurrection is Paul living again. He knew it was not, but a new creation. Yes. Hallelujah. The very Son of God, Christ in you. I mean, honey, he said it in every way it can possibly be said. Reconciliation is that, but what I'm trying to say today is that reconciliation is not just God getting rid of me. Reconciliation is God having His fullness, His satisfaction, His finished work in His Son who lives in me. So reconciliation, you understand, is not really fulfilled in me being dead. And yet, Romans 10. Let's look at that. I'm so far away from this now. Let's just go where we can right quick. Romans 10. No, excuse me. Romans 5, verse 10. Romans 5, verse 10. And Paul picks this up and he takes it all the way through the 8th chapter. We won't do that this morning. If when we were enemies, most most of us, I mean, even in considering ourselves, you know, we sinners and all that we call that, unregenerate, we don't really consider ourselves to be enemies of God, but Paul does every time he talks about it. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. Now, how many of you know when he died, you died? Paul has to go on and explain that in the 6th chapter, just a few sentences on down here. He has to go on and explain that. But how many of you understand that reconciliation? I mean, why would reconciliation be attached to his death? Because what was his death other than bringing me and you into the body of his death at the cross? Certainly. What was the reconciliation was not just of Jews, of Gentile also. And it wasn't the reconciling of Jew to Gentile. It was reconciling the Gentile and the Jew to Christ. And how foolish I was last night in looking at all this. I actually thought we were going to get to start at Ephesians 2, verse 10, and go all the way through, step by step, verse 18, where we find that reality. He is our peace. It's the same word, rest. Peace, rest. How? Who hath made both one? How? How? By bringing both of them. I'm ad-libbing here, but you read it. He tore down, the words tore down, destroyed, slew. My Lord. He brought them and made them one in the body of his death. And what he did, he killed both of them. They weren't reconciled at a peace table. No, no, no. Now, peace comes. Rest comes. But it's by reconciliation. He took the Jew and the Gentile and crucified both of them in one body of his death. The body by the cross. You read that there. You read that there. And out of that death came one new man at peace with God. That man not a Jew, nor a Gentile. That man being the resurrected Christ himself. Who was resurrected out of the death of the Jew and the Gentile, hon? Now tell me, who out of the death of humanity, which is Jew and Gentile, who? Who came up out from among the dead by the glory of God the Father? You know it as well as I do. The Son of God. But it's that Son who lives in us and who himself is the Sabbath. The rest. The reconciliation. Complete. Perfect. Rest. Reconciliation. Not just me dead. It is me not living. And that's where people say, oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. We have come from, the Bible says, God don't, we did. We take the Bible. Might as well have a big old baseball bat going around just beating each other with them, you know, because that's the way we do it. The Bible says, we have passed from death unto life. Yes, God love you, you have. You passed from you to him. Thanks be unto the glory of God. You passed from an old creation to a new creation by the man who lives in that creation and whose body that creation is. That's how you have come from death unto life. And that's exactly what I'm telling you. But it's not you living. It's Christ living in you. It's Christ made unto you. Oh yes. Unto your soul. But it's not your soul just getting some touch from God or some salvation or some forgiveness. Oh, okay, I forgive you. No, honey, that's not. Come on. We're misusing all of those words, misunderstanding all of them. God's salvation is not a redo. It is not a redo. It is a reconciliation. Hallelujah. That brings us to this day. Or in God. That's how God reconciles to himself his creation. Because his whole creation comes by that way. It comes by the cross. It comes by the door. Or it's not. He's not living in it. No man can come the way, the truth, but by me. And if you want to find yourself looking in the Sabbath day, it ain't going to get it done. Because the whole day says God lives here. And we looked at the other night. What does Jesus say? Do you not believe, do you not understand that the Father liveth in me and I in him? Well, in that day, and he's talking to them about that. He's going to the cross when he's talking to his disciples. In that day, when your rest, your comfort will come, I will not leave you. I'm leaving, but I will not leave you without comfort. I will come to you. And I will be in you. I am your rest. But again, see, our natural mind, that just means doing nothing. The type of it was that. But the reality of it is Christ living. Perfect peace is who he is. Christ is our peace. That's that right there in Ephesians 2. Verse 10 starts out with, you are his workmanship, created of God in Christ Jesus. Starts out that way. And then it eliminates the you part. It eliminates the Jew and the Gentile. Introduces the true newness, the true substance of our salvation, Christ in you. You're trying to tell me I don't have a life. I am not. That's what you're hearing. I'm telling you, you only have one life. And it's not you trying to live or you living. Honey, salvation is not you and I going back to be what Adam was before he sinned. He didn't have this life then. The first was never spiritual. The second man, the Lord from heaven. Read it yourself. Christ in you. What I'm telling you, darling, and what the Lord would have us to know is that we've got more life than you ever thought you did. You've got more life than you'll ever find in yourself trying to be holy, trying to be righteous, trying to be. He will bring you into the rest of the faith of the Son of God, of the knowledge of Jesus Christ, into a rest of seeing, my God, it's not me. It is him. It is him. And I just wrote here, and I'll just end with it. There is a day, a time, and I'm not talking about to come. I mean that's in you. It isn't time that that who Christ is hasn't come. It's that we don't know him. As Paul says in Philippians 3, and I read it the other night, we don't know him. Paul says, as I desire to know him. But this one thing I press on. It isn't that fullness is not in you, it is that we don't fully know him. So when I say there is a day, a time, a rest, it's in you. There is a day, a time, a rest where it is not about me, or we, or us. It's that reality of Christ in which Sabbath surrounds you like a cloak, like a clothing to be clothed upon, and fills you as joy and peace and rest. My God in heaven, hon, surrounds you and fills you. Creation at rest is the creation where the man at rest lives. And if we had gone through Ephesians 2, we'd have seen, and I mentioned it a while ago, it's the man, the new man, that comes forth. Jew and Gentile, the body of his death. The resurrection, one comes out, not Jew, not Gentile, not male, no, none of that. Who is it? It's the Lord Jesus, the Son of God, who says, I am the resurrection and the life. Hallelujah. It's him. Creation at rest is the creation where the man at rest lives. Hun, we try to find ourselves in that creation for God's sake. Blessed darling, honey, sweetie, you are that creation. I am. We are. You're trying to find the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. We need to see him who lives. You are that creation. Any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. We're talking about the man that lives there. The rest. The one who lives in every particle of it. My God, the one who speaks it all into existence, not with natural words, but you're born again of the eternal Word of God. Just like everything that is seeable in time, in space rather, was created by him, for him, through him. Oh, then it goes on, and he is the head, the beginning of a new creation. And the fullness and the substance of it. A creation that lives because he lives in it and for no other reason. Under his body because he lives in you. Is it such a hard thought to accept that he ought to be the one living in his body? That's what we're talking about. The confusion comes when I try to do it. In my mind, in my understanding, I try. And it just confuses the truth. Paul says it frustrates the grace of God. Well, what's the answer? Seeing the one who does. God's answer is to bring light upon the situation. To reveal light. Here's your life. Here he is. When he who is our life shall appear. Hallelujah. Well, reconciled by his death, my death, but made whole, brought to perfect rest by him and him alone. Living in me. So back to our verse. If when we're enemies, we are reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more. Every time Paul uses this word, much more, it is with direct reference to Christ. Direct reference to Him. Every time. You can look at it. Much more. Being reconciled, we shall be saved, Greek term, made whole by His life. Now, I haven't said anything other than that. I just pointed out that it's in you. In the reality of that, in the light of that, walking in today, the light of that, we find rest. A rest that is beyond our natural imagination. Because it's not Adam's rest, it's God's rest that we are brought into. The finished work of God is His Son. Father, thank You. Thank You for this day. Thank You for this time that we have been given of You to consider eternity and the reality. Reality of Christ in us. My Lord God, this. You guys just join hands where you're sitting, please. Lord, bless this people. Bless this place. Bless the work and labor of their hands. Give them the means, the provision, the supply necessary to the finishing of that to which they have put their hands to facilitate for a ministry of Christ. Bless them, I pray. Bless them as they come in. Bless them as they go out. Let in all of this, let Thy Son be revealed in those who are in this place. Oh, hallelujah. Thank You for it, Lord. Let it be so. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.